Welcome to Passionate Reply, and welcome to Great Albums. Today I'll be talking about an album that many would consider OMD's best, and many would consider the last great album they ever made, 1983's Dazzle Ships, their fourth studio LP. It has a reputation that precedes it as a strange, experimental, and avant-garde album. And I can't argue with that too much when it has tracks that sound like this. The most obvious thing one can say about Dazzle Ships is that it's dense and rich with samples. You'll hear found sounds ranging from a speak and spell toy to a radio broadcast from Czechoslovakia. It's a magpie's nest constructed of garbage and baubles, collage-like and conscientiously artificial. And OMD's Paul Humphries and Andy McCluskey managed to make it before sampling became easier and hence more widespread later in the 1980s, thanks to advancements in digital technology. In its own day, it was, famously, a huge flop, baffling even the critics, which makes it tempting to argue that the world simply wasn't ready for it. Popular legend says that Humphries and McCluskey were essentially forced to make increasingly soft, pop-oriented music for years afterward, usually at the hands of their label's higher-ups. Is that story really true? Well, I don't know, and I'm not sure if anybody really does, but I think it's important that we entertain some doubt. Regardless of its actual veracity, this legend is offering us a simplistic narrative of art and capital butting heads, and one that we see repeated all too often in music journalism. It's a story that expects us to believe that experimental music is good by default and the natural goal of music and all the people who make it, and conversely, that accessible music is bad, and anyone who writes a song you can dance to is always after profit, never craft. Ultimately, though, the most important reason why I'm asking you to leave this question at the gate is that it's simply a less interesting way to think about art. What I think is truly ingenious about OMD is their ability to combine a pop sensibility with that bleeding-edge experimentation, and vice versa. I don't think of Dazzle Ships as just an inscrutable, esoteric musical ready-made, but rather something capable of animating and enriching a bunch of otherwise mundane sounds. A word I might use for it is challenging, because it isn't simply off-putting, it has a certain charm that invites you to stick around and work through it, and you don't feel like it's a waste of your time. I think the underlying pop DNA offered by Dazzle Ships is a big part of that. Take its lead single, Genetic Engineering, for example. Efficient, logical, effective, and practical, using all resources to the best of our ability. Changing, designing, adapting our mentality, improving our ability for a better way of life. In Genetic Engineering, the samples from that speak and spell are contrasted with a more traditional chorus, which rises above the chaos, stirring and anthemic. It's a song full of friction, not only between these musical ideas, but in ideas about technology and our future. Like many great works of electronic music, especially earlier in its history, Dazzle Ships is deeply concerned with science and technology and the ways they've structured our world. These guys wrote Enola Gay a few years earlier, sure, but there's much more than Luddite dystopian thinking here. Dazzleships walks a tightrope between romantic adoration of the promise of a better tomorrow and the tempered uncertainty we're forced to develop when we witness the devastation our most horrifying inventions have wrought already. Something that helps sell the former is the motif of childhood. In addition to the speak and spell, genetic engineering also features a children's toy piano and prominently references children in its lyrics. And Telegraph, the album's other single, sees fit to reference Daddy. Like these and the centering of not-so-new technologies like telegraphy and radio carry us backward in time. Dazzleships has a sense of nostalgia for the technological explosion of the mid-century when household technologies were improving in ways that saved time and labor and faith in better living through science was high. It's not a wistful or introspective nostalgia, but rather one that taps into the bustling excitement of living through that era. That retro styling helps us situate ourselves in a childlike mindset, optimistic but somewhat naive. Children are highly imaginative and become enthralled with possibility, but don't always understand every implication their actions have. But, as I said, Telegraph and Genetic Engineering were the album's singles. The typical track on Dazzleship sounds more like ABC Auto Industry. The track listing is structured such that these more conventional songs are surrounded by briefer and more abrasive intrusions. They become signals in the noise, as though we're listening to them on the radio, or ships rising above some stormy seas. Several tracks, such as International, also feature a more dissonant intro on top of that, crowding their main melodies inward.
The Youth Anti-Imperialist Tribune was also addressed by a young girl from Nicaragua whose hands had been cut off at the wrists by the former Somoza Guard. Veronica Merkel of the German Federal Republic had this to say.
Also, ich habe eine Ausbildung gemacht als Industriekaufmann und wurde nach der Ausbildung nicht übernommen. Ich habe also eine abgeschlossene Berufsausbildung und so wie mir geht das.
Over the years, many critics have been quick to contrast Dazzleships with OND's other albums, but I actually think it has a lot in common with their preceding LP, 1981's Architecture and Morality, and seems to me to flow naturally from the direction the band had already been going in. Architecture and Morality is a lively mix with moody instrumentals like Sealand, guitar-driven numbers like The New Stone Age, and catchy, intuitive pop songs like Souvenir. Architecture and Morality proved to be their most successful album, when its title track sounds like this.
We'll be right back.
able to see how it's tremendously different than the title track of Dazzle Ships, which leads us on a harrowing sea chase with radar pings quickly closing in. Nautical theme is a great segue to discuss the album's visual motif. Like all of OMD's first five albums, its sleeve was designed by Peter Saville, most famous for his stunning work for New Order. The cover and title were inspired by a painting Saville had seen, Edward Wadsworth's Dazzle Ships in Dry Dock at Liverpool, which portrays World War I warships painted in striking zebra-like geometric patterns. These sharply contrasting razzle-dazzle designs weren't camouflage, but rather served to confuse enemy forces' attempts to track them and predict their motions. Dazzle ships were killing machines that fought dirty, and they were also beautiful. It's a potent, complex symbol, and it's a natural fit for an album that's also capricious, perplexing, and captivating in its uniquely modern terror. Saville's sleeve design features both a die-cut design as well as a gatefold. Peeking through the cover's portholes reveals the interior, where we find a map of the world divided by time zones. It's yet another reminder of how technology has reshaped the planet, connecting the human race while also creating divisions. Earlier, I argued that Dazzle Ships isn't that different from OMD's preceding LP, and I'd also suggest that their follow-ups to it aren't all that different either. It's easy to see the influence of Dazzle Ships on their most recent work, made after reforming the group in the late noughties and informed by the critical reevaluation and cult acclaim of their alleged masterpiece, but even in the 80s, they basically continued the pattern of layering easy-to-love, obvious single-choice tracks alongside more experimental, sample-heavy ones.
My eyes, I'll shut my brain. I can't stand this mockery. I can't stand.
The greatest of pop hitmakers can't maintain a streak in the charts forever. It's not the nature of mainstream pop charts. Not even in the 1980s, when you could get away with quite a lot of electronic weirdness, at least for a while. Looking back and listening to Maid of Orléans, it's almost hard to believe it was one of OMD's biggest hits. Is it really less weird than something like Telegraph? Perhaps they had simply reached the end of their imperial phase. Whether they really had that stern talking to or not. It's not so much that Dazzle Ships isn't weird, so much as it is foreseeable that a nerdy left-of-center band like OMD would have come up with it. Dazzle Ships is excellent! It's a great album, but it's good enough that I think it deserves to be heard and valued on its own terms. The album is too goddamn good, too compelling, too spellbinding to be reduced to that one album the plebs were too dumb to really get. I'm not clearing the air because I think this album is overrated, but because I think it deserves better, deeper discourse than it gets. A truly great album is great whether it sells or it doesn't, right? My advice is to never let art intimidate you, no matter how obtuse people say it is. Send your ship on that plunge into the dark waters of the unknown. You might find something beautiful. Personally, my favorite track overall is Radio Waves, an irresistibly fun cut that could easily become a third single. Since Genetic Engineering and Talagrav live on side one of the record, Radio Waves is really the only reprieve we get on side two, smack in its middle. It really stands out in context, almost like the opposite of how a more conventional album might have one out there track that catches you off guard. Aside from all of that, though, the song also stands perfectly well alone. I have a real soft spot for music about music, how it's made, how it's transmitted, and Radio Waves is simply one hell of a ride. That's all for today. Thanks for listening.